Good morning, El Sobrano United Methodist Church, and welcome to worship this morning. Please join us in our first warm-up hymn today. Give thanks. 2036 or read, yes, 2036 in the little black hymnal.
Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done. He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given Jesus Christ, His Son. And now let the weak say, poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us.
Our next song is We Are the Church, number 558 in your hymnal, if you want to look at the music.
Church is not a building. The church is not a steeple. The church is not a resting place. The church is a people.
I am the church. You are the church. We are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world. Yes, we're the church together.
With many kinds of faces, all colors and all ages, too, from all times and places.
I am the church. You
church together. Sometimes the church is marching, sometimes it's bravely burning, sometimes it's riding, sometimes hiding, always it's learning.
I am the church, you are the church, we are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world, yes, we're the church together.
And when the people gather, there's singing and there's praying, there's laughing and there's crying, sometimes all of it saying,
I am the church, you are the church, we are the church together. All who follow Jesus all around the world, yes, we're the church together.
Hello, and again, welcome to El Sobrante United Methodist Church. My name is Reverend Emily Pickens-Jones, and thank you so much for being in worship on this rainy day, whether you are in person or watching online, or maybe you're watching a little bit later on in our recording. You are so welcome in this place. I really appreciate the help of Peggy, Jacqueline, and Lori as they're filling in for Reverend Eileen today, as she takes a much-deserved day off. And so I really appreciate you helping out. And we're a little bit short-staffed today with some technical things. So if there are a few hiccups, just don't mind them. We're good, right? We're good. We're having fun. We're here to worship together, and that's the most important thing. Amen? So we are in a new season. I know it's hard when we take the decorations down, isn't it? It's kind of like, oh, man. But at least we still have our banners from our Celtic series, right, that really spice up the place. And you are the decorations now. We have poinsettias still, yes. We are in a new season. Last week, we celebrated Epiphany. And for those of you who weren't here last week, we did a Star Words practice where everybody, and not Star Wars, once again, not Star Wars, Star Words, where everybody picked a word that would help direct them this year. So I'll have them after worship at the back of the church when you all come out. If you didn't get one last week, you can get one then. No, you cannot get a different one if you didn't like the one you got last week. Has anybody put your star word up anywhere? Yeah? Have you been looking at it every day? Yeah, I know that the rest has put theirs in their kitchen. I thought that was a great idea, so I did that too. Put it on my fridge. That was Epiphany. And so now what, right? Now what? Everybody's gone home. The magi, the sheep, the shepherds, everybody has gone home. And we're in this long season of what we call ordinary time, which is a terrible name. It implies boring, right, to me. But this season is really anything but. This is the time we're called to be those that go to visit Jesus, right? So he may no longer be at the manger. We may be taking down our decorations, but we are still here. We are going to see Jesus wherever he may be. And so we're starting our new series today called The Glimpses of the Kingdom. And in the coming weeks, we will consider some of the more famous passages of scripture to help us shape a vision of the life we are called to live. Not just a special kind of life, like in Christmas, but an everyday kind of life, an ordinary life that isn't ordinary. Because we believe that followers of Christ who live their faith day by day are anything but ordinary, amen? We stand out, we become models and mentors, we are examples of what life is all about. At least that's our hope. Right, and our belief that our lives represent the kingdom of God. So we get excited. We find extraordinary things in the living of life. And so let us embrace this call with grace and with joy. And I invite our liturgist, Marilyn Lomelino, to lead us in a special call to worship that is written in the style of an epistle of Paul. Will you please stand in body or in spirit?
you.
You're welcome.
And we're not ordinary. Will you please join me in the call to worship? To the church in El Sobrante, located on Appian Way, to make a difference to those sanctified in Christ Jesus, saved to serve humbly and dependably, to those called to be holy, serving as living witnesses of God's transforming grace.
Let us raise our voices unashamedly, rivaling heaven's angels, to praise our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let us lift every voice and sing to our Master and Maker.
Please join us in singing Bring Forth the Kingdom, number 2190 in the Black Hymnal.
You are salt for the earth, O people,
salt for the kingdom of God.
Share the flavor of life, O people,
life is the kingdom of God. Bring forth the kingdom of mercy, bring forth the kingdom of peace, bring forth the kingdom of justice, bring forth the city of God.
You are a light on the hill, O people,
light for the city of God.
Shine so holy and bright, O people,
shine for the kingdom of God. Bring forth the kingdom of mercy, bring forth the kingdom of peace, bring forth the kingdom of justice, bring forth the city of God.
You are seed of the word, O people,
bring forth the kingdom of God.
Seeds of mercy and seeds of justice
grow in the kingdom of God. Bring forth the kingdom of mercy, bring forth the kingdom of peace, bring forth the kingdom of justice, bring forth the city of God.
We are a blessed and a pilgrim people,
bound for the kingdom of God.
Love our journey and love our homeland.
Love is the kingdom of God. Bring forth the kingdom of mercy. Bring forth the kingdom of peace. Bring forth the kingdom of justice. Bring forth the city of God. Kingdom of mercy, bring forth the kingdom of peace, bring forth the kingdom of justice, bring forth the city of God.
We had a little out of order, but we'll go back to the passing of the peace, the time where we recognize that we are all here in worship together, either in person or online. So make sure you wave hi to the camera as you're passing the peace today, recognizing that in this new world, right, we've got people worshiping everywhere, and alleluia for that. So I say to you now, may the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
And send big hugs to everybody. Have air hugs. Or give physical hugs to those around you if you'd like. It's good to be in worship together.
You may be seated. Thank you. The first scripture this week is found in the book of Psalm, chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. We will be reading responsibly.
Oh Lord, do not withhold your mercy. Let your steadfast love preserve me. Steadfast love, preserve me.
I have waited patiently for the Lord, who inclined to me and heard my cry.
The Lord drew me up from the desolate pit, out of the miry bog, set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure.
The Lord put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God.
Many will see and be in awe and put their trust in the Lord.
Blessed are those who make the Lord their trust, who do not turn to the proud, to those who go astray from after false gods.
O Lord, my God, you have multiplied your wondrous deeds and your thoughts towards us. None can compare with you.
Were I to proclaim and tell of them, they would be more than can be numbered.
Sacrifice and offerings to you do not desire, but you have given me an open ear.
Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required.
Then I said, lo, I come. In the roll of the book it is written of me. I delight to do your will, O God. Your law is within my heart. O Lord, do not withhold your mercy. Let your steadfast love preserve me.
I have told the glad news of deliverance in the great congregation.
Lo, I have not restrained my lips, as you know, O Lord.
I have not hid your saving help within my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your salvation.
I have not concealed your steadfast love and faithfulness from the great congregation.
O Lord, do not withhold your mercy from me.
Let your steadfast love and faithfulness ever preserve me. O Lord,
for our special music today, we're going to sing We Are the Church.
No, and, with the people we have.
With the people we have, sorry. We already sang We Are the Church.
And you'll be singing this later.
You'll be singing it at the end.
With the people we have, we can build a new horizon. With the people we have, we can risk a desert road. With the people we have, we can wade the troubled waters. God is working in us. We can build better world.
With the people we have, we can sing a song of welcome. With the people we have, we can join our hands in hope. With the people we have, we can move a mighty mountain.
Is working in us. We can build a better world. with the people we have. We can dare to be a witness with the people we have. We can choose the way of love with the people we have. We can draw the circle wider. God is working in us. We can build a better world. God is working in us to repair what has been broken. God is working in us to redeem what once was lost. God is working in us to resist when evil threatens. God is working in us. We can build a better world. God is working in us. We can build a better world.
The second scripture this week is found in the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sathenas, to the church of God that is in Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, together with all those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Please join us now in singing, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Please stand.
You can't sing this one sitting down. Anyway.
Sorry.
In their courses of life.
You may be seated. I'm so pleased that now that we are out of our Epiphany series, I get to start doing Time for Young and Young at Heart again. So if you are young or young of heart, this time is for you. You can come a little bit closer to the screen, or always the invitation is open for anybody who's feeling young at heart to come on forward today. Has anybody here ever been afraid? I saw a couple two hands, like, all right, what are you all afraid of? People? Yeah.
Boogeyman.
The boogeyman. Mm-hmm. You have a reason for that one. Bad dogs. Getting sick? Mm-hmm. In this day and age, for sure. Yeah. Flooding. This is a big one right now. Reason why I'm not wearing a robe today is because my office is flooded and everything smells quite mildewed. So yes, we are having a fear of flooding right now. We put out and also leaking from roofs. We've been putting out plastic tarp because you can see all of the leaking that is happening. It's a real fear. Anyone else? Forgetting driving in the rain, and you had to do that this morning. Thank you for being here. Illness of loved ones, yeah, pain of loved ones, or yeah, you know, loved ones going through a hard time. I'm afraid of thunder, I'll be real. I'm like a real California girl here where I really struggle with it. Everybody else, I feel like from Midwest and East Coast is always like, really? Thunder happens all the time. Well, it doesn't happen here very often. It scares me. Spiders, snakes, anybody? Yeah, we've all got fears. And it may seem like that we have many fears in our lives. And when you're afraid, do you tell somebody? Or do you keep it to yourself? Keep it, depends on the kind of fear we have. Yeah, maybe you tell a grown-up or a fellow grown-up for you big kids here. Maybe you tell a sibling or a best friend. Who else do we talk to when we're afraid? God. Yes, when we're afraid, we turn to God. And so I want to remind you of this psalm that we read today from Psalm 40. David, who is a songwriter, among many other things, shares this psalm with us. And as I read it, listen for words that may suggest that David might have been afraid. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. What words do you hear from David that suggest he might have been afraid? Cry, yep. I heard the words, yeah, cry, fall into a slimy pit. That's a different version than we heard earlier. Falling into mud and mire. Does anybody know what mire is? Yeah, I think bog is like the closest thing. It's like deep mud or slush, right? So what's worse than falling into mud, right? Falling into a deep mud or mire. To continue the psalm, he set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord. This second part sounds completely different than that first part, right? Do you notice that? Not words of fear this time, but words like rock, firm place to stand, a new song, praise, trust, and blessed. What changed for David? When David was afraid, where did he turn? To God. David put his trust and faith in God. This weekend and tomorrow, we remember a man who always turned to God, even when he was afraid, and he was afraid a lot. Reverend Martin Luther King had a dream that one day this country would be a place where people with different skin colors treated one another with respect and worked together so they wouldn't be afraid. A day when there would be justice for everyone and no one should be afraid. I wonder how many times during his life he must have felt the same as David. afraid, crying out to the Lord. And like David, Martin Luther King Jr. put his faith on a solid rock, the solid rock of Jesus. Makes me think of the hymn. If you know it, sing along with me. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. And so when we are afraid, we must remember that we put our trust and hope in the solid rock of Christ Jesus. I'll do that the next time there's some thunder. Let's pray. Loving God, thank you for being our rock during times when we are nervous, we're overwhelmed, or afraid. Remind us to look to you and see how you are with us. Amen. Thanks for being in church today. Something else that can be pretty scary. Hold on, let me change the slide. Is learning something new, right? It can be beautiful, but it's also quite difficult and pretty scary. I've never been skiing in my life, and if I learned that I was going to go skiing tomorrow, I would feel terrified. I would spend probably the rest of my day both in excitement and dread. And I would do every bit of research I could. I'd watch YouTube tutorials, probably read instructions, call, text, email everyone I knew who skied. I'd call for their advice. We like to know what we're doing before we do it, right? We like to know what we're getting into. We like to feel well-versed and comfortable. And I think in this day and age where information is just everywhere, sometimes it feels a little overwhelming to ask somebody for that advice, right? Like we should know it already. So, instead of asking somebody, we could Google it. I know that that's something that we're all wrestling with. To admit that you don't know something can be seen as a weakness. And when people feel embarrassed or they don't know something, what happens? They feel ashamed. And they act defensively, right? We see this all over the place. We really struggle with it. I think we're always trying to prove that we know more than others. Hate to say it, but right, this is in politics all the time, right? This defensiveness. I also think we struggle with the idea of needing to learn more instead of being content with what we already know or what we might be experiencing. If I only had this one thing, if only I read the right book, knew more, had more, I might be perfect at something. We do this in church culture in this day and age all the time. We would be the best, most successful church if only we had, insert whatever here. What are things that we say all the time?
Money.
Money. You never say that. Yeah, Marilyn. More space. What else? People. Membership. What, certain kinds of people I hear all the time. Young people, right? You all say it to me all the time. It's funny when as a younger pastor coming into a church, I'm always like expected to have this magic wand and the young people will suddenly appear, right? Like it's not exactly how that works. Yeah, where are they? I'm really failing, right? If I only had that one young person, yeah. Where's my magic wand? And I get it. It's so easy to get trapped into this way of thinking. Our roof would be better if we had more money, right? But why do we want better? Is it so we can feel good about ourselves? Or is it so we can do great things for God? This is a struggle. This is a really difficult thing to talk about sometimes, especially when we see other churches that have everything, right? That have all of these people that do all of these amazing things. Honestly, I'd pick our church any day. We have a wonderful church with the people we have. And we look this week into the great orator and civil rights hero. That was Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. What kind of nation would we be? What kind of church if we learn from his example of faith and life. As it is, I'm still learning. I'm still in process. You know, this is what we're all experiencing. Does it sound like something that you've said before? Maybe not just in church, but in life. I'd lose the weight I want to if only I had this, or I could have the house I wanted it if only I did this, or I'd have this ability, right? If only I did this. We're always keeping ourselves to these high expectations. And I do it all the time as a pastor. If I knew more, if I had more, I'd be so much better. We'd be so much better. We get caught up in a trap of, if I could be a person like this, if I had. It sounds as though my lack of accomplishments is due to some external thing that I am missing. Some knowledge, some skill, some resource. If I just had that, then all kinds of things could happen. As it is, not so much. And our text this week includes Paul's assertion that the church has everything it needs to be the church. Did you hear me? The church has everything it needs to be the church. That is an amazing and powerful statement of faith. Too often we spend this time wishing that we had more people or more resources or more volunteers or more activities or more space or whatever. But what if instead we were simply thankful? Let's be thankful for the gifts we have, for the people we have, for how they give of themselves and their resources, and give thanks for the mission and witness that we are able to do week by week. Of course, we want to encourage more, right? Of course. But that's not because we are lacking. We encourage more because we don't want anyone to miss out of the joy of being the body of Christ, the joy of serving, the joy of worship. We come from an attitude of abundance and not scarcity. I didn't hear any amens, but I heard it on the inside, right? I mean, it's there. That's why we're here, right? And I wish there's so many lonely people out there that could use a community like ours. We have that joy, that privilege to be able to share it with others, because being part of the body of Christ is pretty fantastic. And oddly enough, the passage for this week was not written to deal with this attitude with the church in Corinth. If anything, it was actually trying to do the opposite. It's one of those mysterious God kinds of ways where texts like this can apply to different situations. The problem in Corinth that brought about Paul's letter was not the lack of confidence. It was the fact that there was a group of Christians in the church who consider themselves better than the others. They believed that their ability to speak in tongues was a signal that they were more equipped, more favored, more special than those whose gifts were more mundane. They even thought that they didn't need to listen to anyone but themselves. That is why Paul begins by stressing his credentials. Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God. How do you argue with anyone with a title like that, right? Is that how you introduce yourselves? Anybody? No? Okay. He also reminds them of their call, which is twofold. First, they are called to be saints. You would think that this kind of talk might make their heads even bigger, right? Add to the arrogance. You know, how many of us look forward to having saint in front of our names one day? Not many of us, I expect. Yet for Paul, the word saint meant someone who recognizes the need for someone in particular to help them grow and learn. That's not what we usually talk about for saints. A saint is one who has said yes to Jesus Christ. It carried no honor except the honor of the one who called. It made no guarantee that the behavior of this person is exemplary. A saint was someone beholden to God through Jesus Christ. Beholden, I love that word. Isn't that a great word, beholden? We don't use it much, but it conveys images of being wrapped up as well as belonging. We are beholden to God. We are beholden to one another. It shows God, it shows it through more than us, because we are wrapped up in that presence and that light. The good things that we do, the bright face that we show, is the face of God shining through us. Paul was reminding the Corinthians that they belong to God and was asking them to examine their behavior to see if they still fit that description. When you become arrogant, you move the self to the center and anything else has to make way, right? But if God is supposed to be at the center, then arrogance has no place in the community of faith. In the same way, our doubts do not feed the life of the church, except to teach us what we do have. The second thing that Paul wanted to remind the Corinthians is that they were a part of something larger than themselves. I say that all the time here, right? Being part of something larger than ourselves, larger than our day to day, right? He called them saints, quote, together with all those who in every place call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Jesus isn't the exclusive property of those who seek to divine him in very specific ways. We can think of a few folks in the news that do that. The Corinthians had remade Christ in their image, and Paul was trying to help them take a larger view. You are part of something bigger than your eyes and bigger than your imagination even. Whoa. All those who in every place who can comprehend something like that. It's a way of putting things into perspective. Before he even really gets to the meat of this letter, I mean, this is like the first bit of this very long letter in 1 Corinthians. And I think both of these points are really part of Martin Luther King's legacy to the church as well. You know, that a reminder, first of all, that we are called to live not by our own wisdom, not by our own preferences or prejudices, but by the call of God, the vision of the kingdom that defines our hopes and prayers and service, and that we are in this together. It is not just me or my church, my circle, the ones like me, the ones I get along with. No, our vision is always bigger, always for inclusion, always for beloved community. That is how we honor the memory of the servant of God. He became the conscience of a nation for a brief time and is needed again today. And Martin Luther King wasn't perfect. He was always growing and learning too, just like saints do. Paul tells us, particularly those of us who don't think that we measure up, that we have been enriched. Not that we will be, or we could be, or we might be, but that we have been. We're already doing it. It's already part of who we are. That's why we talk about spiritual gifts, right? That everybody here offers something to our church. You don't have to be good at anything in particular. Everybody is already good at something. You offer something to this church, right? And that is a beautiful thing. We don't have to get to that point of, oh, we're complete now. Now we can do all the things we want to do, right? That's not how this works. What does our church have? Call out some things. What is it that our church has? Community? Love? Members? Each other? Faith? Faithfulness, that's a good one. A beautiful place. Y'all, I remember the first time I walked in this sanctuary and I was blown away. This is a beautiful sanctuary, right? We have a beautiful campus. What was that? Potlucks. That's one we do have to be thankful for. And laughter and tears, right? We have people we can be with when we need to cry or we need to laugh. Memories. Mm-hmm. Acceptance to all. I'd go further than that. Like, it's like it's more than inclusion. It's an embrace of all, right? Music. We've got so much here. And I do hear it regular saying, oh, our church doesn't have enough of this, but we have a lot. We have so much. We have an abundance of blessings from God. We may not always feel like we know what we're doing. And yeah, sure, sometimes we go, oh, but if only we had this. It's just part of things. But we are always learning on the job, right? We're always learning how to ski. We're always learning how to do what we can to be the best we can be. We see that in one another. We are learning to be the church, the saints we are called to be. Thanks be to God.
Please join us now in singing our call to worship.
Prayer. Call to prayer.
Call to prayer, I'm sorry. Born in human likeness. And it's a round. If you'd like to choose a round number, we'll sing it all together once, and then we'll break into a round. One, two, or three. Jacqueline will start. All together.
Born in human likeness, found in human form, Jesus, God is with us. We proclaim your glory. Born in human likeness, found
as a reminder, praying looks like so many different things, right? You can have your eyes closed and your head bowed. You can have your arms open and looking up. You pray in the way that feels good to you. Will you please pray with me? With hearts full of love and spirits encouraged with praise, we offer our thanks to you, our Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. Thanks for those whose voices call our names and bring us deep, deep joy. Thank you for those who inspire us to be better people. Thank you for those who named us and shaped us. We give thanks for the special meaning our names have in the ears and hearts of others. Oh God, you called us into faithful fellowship with Christ, that we, with all who call upon his name, are his holy people. One church, one body, throughout time and space. Draw near to us, we pray. Christ Jesus, as members of the one body, we are joined to our siblings and you throughout the world. We thank you for the other churches in this area, from our own denomination and others. We thank you for the richness this diversity brings and long for the day where we are truly united in service of you in and for the world. May they be filled with your spirit as they eagerly wait for the coming of the kingdom of God. Draw near to us, we pray. Kingdom building one, you called us to come and see. May we see your kingdom. We pray for the world that seems so in need of it. We seek to find refuge from the storms, the floods, the wars, the violence, and the harm. Draw near to us, we pray. We pray for those who worry what the future holds for their livelihoods in the coming months and years, especially for the unhoused. Draw near to us, we pray. We pray for people in our communities who struggle with health, ability, aging, and weary bodies, and all those who care for them. Help those who struggle know that they are not a burden. Draw near to them, we pray. Oh God, our help in ages past. Oh God, our rock. Oh God, the one whom we turn to when we are afraid. You have given us so much to be thankful for, and forgive us when we don't always recognize it. Forgive us when we feel overwhelmed by fear, by dread, by feelings that were not enough. Give us strength, oh God, to be the people that you have called us to be, in whatever age or ability, whatever socioeconomic class, whoever we are, oh God, you have made us in your image. And you have given us everything to be the church in this world. But our lives can be hard, oh God. We know that you are there with us when the going gets rough. Remind us of that. And remind us of the great community we are a part of, where no one is alone, where we can lay down our burdens to you and follow your Son, who taught us so many things, how to live a life fulfilled, and taught us how to say a prayer in whatever wording or language you are comfortable with. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You are a community that gives and gives of your time, your talents, and your money. And there are always ways to give more so that you feel fulfilled, that you feel full of that joy that comes with being part of this community. And so if you would like to give financially, we have a offertory plate at the back, or if those of you who would like to pay online, go to our website. It's very easy to sign up to give a donation if you're able. Let us give thanks for all of the blessings, not just the financial, but all of them, no matter how big or small. I give thanks, and I'm singing a doxology today for all of you who are here. So let us stand in body or in spirit and sing together.
Thank you.
Will you please pray with me? Good and generous God, we bring our gifts to you this day and pray you might dedicate them to your work. We confess that we have too often missed being the church you wanted and needed, and we have placed the blame on not having enough money, members, talent, time, or power. We needed to be reminded by the Apostle Paul that we have all that we need, whatever our circumstances. Renew us, loving God, and give us a new day and another chance. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. Now's your chance to really sing this well. Yeah.
Yeah, sing it like you mean it, with the people we have.
With the people we have, we can hail a new horizon. With the people we have, we can risk a desert road. With the people we have, we can wade the troubled waters. God is working in.
I know in looking at some of those photos, we think of those that may have passed away or those that have moved away. And we do this work in honor of them, right? We continue to thrive and build this community because of people that have shown us the way. And so reach out to those maybe that haven't been here in a while too, those that might be needing a call from one of us. That's how we build a community together. That is how we give thanks for what we already have. So go out in peace, go out knowing that you are loved, and go out knowing that we have what it takes to build a better world. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.